Good afternoon, one and all, and it is always a pleasure. Once you connect with a person who has created his benchmarks within the legal arena and beyond that, just like we have Beyond Law CLC to the effect that we take webinars beyond the law, same way amongst us today, the resource persons, Professor B.T. Kaul, a former chairman of the Delhi Judicial Academy, and he has been on our platform giving insights on the topics and his webinars on the labor law as well as on the IPC. Both have done well, taking into consideration that he's having immense knowledge, and the way he explains the things, they create well within our minds a special space. And the topic, not only for the students of law, because and even for the judicial exams, culpable homicide and murder, has a different space. Similarly, a lawyer practicing may not be practicing on the as they say, on the criminal field of jurisprudence, but still this murder and culpable homicides are the issues which keep on propping up between the lawyers and the common public at large. Even in the newspapers daily, we read about a man has been convicted for culpable homicide or a murder. Keeping in view this fascination as to what would be the homicide, as we all know, homo means same and side means they are derived from the Latin word. And therefore the homicide word has been derived. And what could be the provocation and what are the circumstances which creates from murder to a culpable homicide or vice versa, where it's culpable homicide or it could be a murder. Without taking much time, I would request Professor B.T. Kaul, a well-known speaker, and for his knowledge sharing platform. He's created his own space and benchmark. I request, sir, to give his insights. It's always a pleasure hearing him, not only on this platform, but even otherwise. It's always glad to be in touch with him and have insights on the different perspectives of law. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Vikas. It is a pleasure always to share thoughts with you on your platform. You've been working very hard and giving wonderful sessions to the young lawyers, to the students, and I'm sure they must also include some of the young judges. This topic which I'm going to talk today, I will talk less, have more questions from you, because I have talked on this topic at many platforms, and it's a subject which is very dear to my heart. And I would not like to spend more time in giving a monologue lecture, but I would like certainly to have questions from the audience and answer those questions if I can. I think one of the most important areas in the IPC scheme is the offenses against human body, and especially the distinction between culpable homicide and amounting and not amounting to murder. This is a very important topic, and I have dealt with this subject as a student of law, as a teacher of law in the Judicial Academy and otherwise on different platforms, and find that this is one area where there's a conceptual clarity required, and that is very, very forensic conceptual clarity that needs to be given if one has to appreciate the intent of those who try to bring out this distinction. I personally feel of all the offenses affecting human body, a lot of effort has gone on the part of the drafters, Macaulay and his team. And except for some difficulties here and there, I find it's very scientifically drawn, subject. I will come to those nuances of this subject, and I will come to those scientific scheme that you can see permeating the provisions, especially dealing with offenses affecting human body. And more so when we deal with the distinction between culpable homicide and culpable homicide amounting, not amounting to murder, which is very, very important for our understanding. I think two, three things very at the very outset, which I would like to make clear. The fundamental principle of criminal law, general criminal law I'm talking about, is actus non facit reum nisi mens rea. That is, no act per se is criminal unless it is accompanied by guilty mind. And from this principle also comes out a very clear scheme about the ingredients of an offense. And we broadly say an offense is composite of three essential elements. Offense in the sense O is equal to A plus B plus C. Now A is the mens rea, B is the actus reus, and C is the forbidden consequence. The mens rea must accompany the act. The act must result in a forbidden consequence, and the act and the consequence must be having a causal effect, not the casual effect, you know. They must be directly, it's like Newton's laws of motion coming into operation. To every action, there is equal and opposite reaction. If you give a blow, what is the intensity of the blow? What is the nature of the weapon used? Which part of the body you attacked? How deep the injury has been caused? Which part of the body the injury has been caused are all cumulatively to be taken into account when we deal with offenses affecting human body. I'll come to these issues very, very important. Therefore, let me come first one by one. Actus non facit nisi mens rea principle doctrine has been internalized in almost all provisions of the IPC. You have internal scheme inbuilt in every offense, and I will demonstrate it to you when we go to culpable homicide and culpable homicide amounting, not amounting to murder. But one has to always keep in mind that there are three essential elements of an offense. And in premeditated offense, there are already always four stages in the commission of crime. So elements are three. Premeditated offenses, stages are four. Like we say, intention, preparation, attempt, and forbidden consequence ensuing. Or if the forbidden consequence does not ensue because of the factor independent of the accused, we still say that a person is liable for an attempt. Now, that I'm not dealing with today, but just to introduce you to the various nuances of the criminal law, I thought I must mention today. Now, when we say mens rea, the mens rea is guilty mind. And with respect to the offenses against human body, we have essentially four kinds of mens reas. We say intention to kill or intention to cause bodily injury, knowledge of the consequences, rashness, which we call as advertent negligence, or inadvertent negligence, which we call as negligence, which is culpable negligence. Now, these we will come to slowly, gradually at various stages, but just to say something which is every day we see when we go to a crime column in the newspaper, we always read that the police is investigating into the matter and they're trying to find the motive behind the crime. Now, motive is a very important concept in criminal law, but it is not an essential element of an offense. Now, therefore, I would like to make a distinction at the outset between motive, intention, and knowledge. Now, motive is something which is behind the mind, and this is what you must not lose sight of. Motive prompts you to form an intent. And intent is always within the mind, which we call as a design or an idea, which you want to achieve by doing an act. Motive is behind the mind. Intent is within the mind. That is, when your mind is active, you want to do something which you advertently want to do, which you voluntarily want to do. I'll come to the concept of voluntariness again at some point of time. And then we say knowledge is the awareness of the consequence. The two important concepts which I want to introduce at this stage, every person is presumed to be an person of a sound mind. The burden of proof is on the person who says that he was not a person of sound mind. You know, 105 of the evidence act. And if you are not a person of sound mind, what is the defense? We say unsound is a mind. Now that's section 84 of the IPC. I'll come to that later stage if time permits. But presumption is that all of us are people of sound mind. We have the capacity to form a guilty mind. And we have a mind which can always perceive the consequence of an act. That perception of the consequence of an act is attributed to you as long as you are a person of sound mind and a person of prudent mind. And every person is supposed to be a person of prudent mind. Prudent mind is reasonable man. Of course, reasonable man is not an inflexible concept. It is a flexible concept, we say, moves from society to society. But the question is, how much of a knowledge we attribute to every person, irrespective of the fact, what is the level of the education, what is the level of the, you know, accomplishments he has in life. Everybody ought to know what are the vital parts of the body and what are not vital parts of the body. And the discussion on this subject is very beautifully illustrated by Justice Vivian Bose in Virsa Singh versus State of Punjab. We'll come to that at appropriate stage. Everybody must be attributed with some knowledge about what are the vital parts of the body, what are non-vital parts of the body. What is the, you know, awareness that can be attributed to him about the consequence of his act. Now, when we talk about motive, I said motive prompts you to form an intent, and knowledge is the awareness of the consequence. Now, how much of awareness must be there? That we'll talk about in due course of time. We'll come across a scale, which we say scale is from 1 to 10. And in this scale, we will use concepts like may, possible, likely, most likely, certainty. And this I will come to at a slightly later stage, but let me deal first with some important aspects of mensuria. Mensuria, I said, can be in the form of an intent, like suppose when we go to section 299, which defines culpable homicide, it says intention to kill or intention to cause bodily injury. It also has a clause which says, irrespective of the intent, whether you have an intent or not, but as long as you can be attributed with the knowledge of the consequence of an act, it is also something which has to do with culpable homicide. We'll come to that at a later stage. Now, besides intent to cause bodily injury or to cause death, or knowledge of the consequence that it is likely to cause death, or it may cause death, or it is possible to cause death, all those things will come at a later stage. There are other two mensurias which we talk about. Every person is supposed to be a reasonable man. And therefore, when we say reasonable man, we say prudent man. When we say prudent man, we say he must exercise due care and caution. He must act bona fidely. Section 52 of the Indian Penal Code says, what is bona fide? Nothing is said to be done in good faith. Now, good faith is bona fide. Bona fide is good faith. Nothing is said to be done in good faith or bona fide, which is not done with due care and caution. So therefore, where you lack in care and caution and do not act as a prudent man, and it is a culpable negligence or culpable rashness on your part, knowingly lacking in care, unknowingly lacking care, but you could have taken care had you known, had you cared to know. Now, those are all concepts which we must look at, because section 304A will be coming to, where we shall be talking about causing death by rash or negligent act, not amounting to culpable homicide. A very beautiful classification that we'll have to go and look at. Now, having said that, mensuria can be either in the form of an intention or in the form of a knowledge of the consequence. Now, knowledge of the consequence is different from knowledge of a fact. Knowledge of consequence is always attributed to you as long as your act is a voluntary act. Or further we'll go to when we go to negligence, advertent negligence. And second we say is knowledge of the fact. And that is actually to be proved by the prosecution. And this will come across when we go to section 300, subclass 2. And this is something which I would like to demonstrate there. You must make a distinction between knowledge of a fact and knowledge of the consequence, which is attributed to everybody, irrespective of his knowledge, actual knowledge or not. Now that is another aspect that I would like to do. Now, second is act. What is an act? You see, IPC has its own dictionary. IPC, when it talks about life, when we say offenses against human life, we say life means in section 45, unless the context requires otherwise, life means a life of a human being. Similarly, we have a definition of death, section 46. Unless the context requires otherwise, death means death of a human being. A very important concept that we must understand. Similarly, when we go to section 80, now section 80 falls in the chapter called general exceptions. And section 6 of the IPC tells you that when you read an offense, you have to read it subject to the chapter called general defenses. The very important system that you have to look at IPC is very, you know, IPC has two types of defenses. One is general defense. Second is partial defense. I'll come to those later on. But general defenses, nothing is an offense. After having defined offenses, provided punishment for the offenses, there is a section 6. It says every offense under this code has to be read subject to the chapter general defenses. So therefore, you must understand section 80 says accident or misfortune. Nothing is an offense. I want to read it out to you because it gives you an idea about mens rea. And this is very, very material for a student of law, for a young lawyer to understand. What is accident? What is misfortune? If it is an accident or misfortune, it is not punishable. Only that you have to prove, burden of proof shifts to you because general exceptions are burden shifts from prosecution to the defense. Prosecution has to prove the guilt beyond reasonable doubt. But when you raise a defense under the chapter 4, the Supreme Court has very clearly said that unlike law, civil law, you don't have to plead defenses. It can be coming during the course of appreciation of the evidence also. And when you are dealing with the general defenses, the burden of proof is preponderance of evidence. Now, these are two different aspects of the matter, which is not the subject matter of today, but just to tell you, because I'm dealing with the mens rea part of it. Section 80 says, nothing is an offense which is done by accident or misfortune and without any criminal intention. Mark the words criminal intention, mens rea in the form of criminal intent. Or knowledge. Now I say knowledge in of the consequences. Knowledge in the doing of a lawful act in a lawful manner, in a lawful means, and with proper care and caution. So if you have done an act which is without criminal intent, without any criminal knowledge, with due care and caution, in doing that act, you have acted in a lawful manner, by lawful means, and in a lawful way, it is accident, misfortune, not punishable under criminal law. So therefore, gives you an idea that criminal intent, knowledge of the consequences, lack of proper care and caution are forms of the mens rea that are talked about in IPC. And those are essential elements of various offenses. But when we go to act, we have section 32, 33. Now, section 32 says an act includes a series of acts and includes an illegal omission and also includes a series of illegal omissions. So, what is act? When we say actus reus, we say a physical act, we say an act which gives effect to the criminal intent, poisoning, slapping, hitting, or omitting to do which you are under a legal duty to do it. A neighbor may be starving, I may be under moral obligation to feed him, but I am under no legal obligation to feed him. But if I have a dependent family member and I am under legal obligation to provide food to him and deliberately want to cause his death by starvation, it is an act within the meaning of section 32-33 of the Indian Penal Code. So therefore, this is act. Third is consequences. Act accompanied by guilty mind must result in a forbidden consequence. Now, these three things, if you remember, I think we'll go ahead, we can move ahead and go to the homicides. Now, homicide is killing of a living human being by a human being. But all homicides are not unlawful. There can be lawful homicides. There are unlawful homicides. What are lawful homicides? A judge ordering death sentence, which is upheld by the appellate courts and becomes a final decision. And as a result of that awarding punishment, a hangman hangs him under the directions of the authorities who are executing the orders of the court. These are all lawful homicides. In exercise of the right of private defense, within the limits of the law, if I cause somebody's death to protect my life, is a lawful homicide. An officer, police officer, in an encounter, I'm talking about genuine encounter, against the terrorist, if he causes the death of the terrorist, may be a lawful homicide. So when we talk about homicides here, we talk about unlawful homicides. And all unlawful homicides are not culpable homicides. What are culpable homicide? What is a culpable homicide? A culpable homicide is what is punished, what is defined in section 299. There may be homicide by rash or negligent act not amounting to culpable homicide. That is section 304 ACS. So those are unlawful homicide, but not culpable homicide. What is culpable homicide is very important. That I just want to talk to you. Now, before I go to culpable homicide, let me introduce you that when we talk about offenses against human body, I always say it is from use of criminal force or assault to murder, especially when we are talking about body, when we are talking about hurt. You see, at the bottom of the ladder of these offenses, when we say ladder, we say every step is a higher offense. You have criminal force or assault. Above that, we have hurt as defined in section 319. And it becomes punishable when we say voluntarily causing of a hurt. Above that, when we go, we say voluntarily causing of a grievous hurt. Above that, we will go and we'll see culpable homicide. Above that, we will go, we'll see murder. Therefore, every murder is a culpable homicide. Every culpable homicide is a voluntarily causing of grievous hurt. Plus, every voluntarily causing of grievous hurt is a voluntarily causing of hurt plus. And every voluntarily causing of hurt is a assault plus. So this plus is something which adds to the intensity of the offense, makes it more serious offense. And if you say a murder is a culpable homicide, involves voluntarily causing of hurt, involves voluntarily causing of hurt, involves voluntarily causing of an assault. So therefore you can see But in this process, let me explain something more, which is very, very vital. We have a scale of 10 or 100, whatever you like to call it. And in this scale, I am using Macaulay's scientific terminology. And what is Macaulay's scientific terminology? Macaulay's scientific terminology between act and the consequence. The causal factor I am talking about. Is certain acts may cause death. Certain acts possibly will result in death. Certain acts are likely to result in death, depending upon the nature of the weapon used, part of the body attacked, number of the blows given, intensity of the blows, and the cumulative nature of the injuries on the part of the body. Now I'm moving from may, possible, likely, and then I say most likely, and then I say certainty. Please understand this scheme of things which I'm talking to you. Because this scheme of things will make all the difference in attributing the criminality to the accused. There may be cases whereby your act, the person may die, but death is not a likely consequence. There may be people suffering of serious bodily injury. Not to my knowledge, I give a blow instead of causing hurt, it causes hurt of grave nature and the person dies. If this blow is given to a person of normal health and I do not have the knowledge about this physical infirmity of this man or bodily infirmity of this man, my act has to be judged in relation to the people of normal health. How many people will die? How many people will survive is the question that we have to answer always. So therefore, may, possible, likely, most likely, and certain. These are very important. Like I say, when do I say may? Let us say I say may when people out of 10, 44 people will die. 6 people will survive. More people will survive, less people will die. When do I say possible? I say 50-50. Not 50-50 biscuits, 50-50, 50 people survive, 50 people die. More than may is possible. But less than likely is possible. And in likely, we can say 7 out of 10, 7 people can die, 3 people may survive. When we say most likely, we say up to 99% people may die. Some 1% people may survive. Most likely to die. Sufficient to cause death in ordinary course of nature. And certainty we say 100%. Now let me now take you to what is very important for us to understand. Section 39 defines what is voluntarily. And that is very important for appreciating the distinction between 299, 300. And also distinction between 299 and 304A. Please have a look at section 39. Section 39, every word of section 39 is very important. A person is said to cause an effect. Now that is what I was talking about, Newton's laws of motion. Cause and effect. To every cause, there is an effect. And that's what section 39 says. A person is said to cause an effect voluntarily. Mark the words, voluntarily. It is defining what is voluntarily. when it causes it by means whereby he intended to cause it. He intended to cause it. Whereby he intended to cause it, or by means which at the time of employing those means he knew. Knowledge. Intent as a mens rea, knowledge of the consequence as a mens rea, very important. But what is the most important part of it? Or has reason to believe to be likely to cause it. When do we say voluntarily? We say when it is likely to cause it. So therefore, not may, not possible. For voluntarily, likely is the benchmark. Whether it is hurt, whether it is grievous hurt, or whether it is culpable homicide. Please be very clear on that part of the matter, because I am coming to the most important aspect of the distinction that I am coming to. There may be people who give an injury which causes death but is not likely to cause death. I may be liable only for voluntarily causing of hurt or voluntarily causing of grievous hurt, because it is not likely to cause death. And that is very important for me to go to section 299. Now I go to section 299. But before I go to section 299, I must also tell you the distinction between intention and knowledge. Intention includes knowledge. If I intend it, I ought to know. When Nathuram Godse gave talk, tuck, tuck, he ought to have known that firing on the vital part of the body, the person is in all probability is going to die. So therefore, knowledge is attributed to the person. There may be people who have no intention either to cause death or to cause bodily injury, yet looking at the nature of their act, they ought to have known. And this is the illustration given to section 39. Please look at illustration to section 39. It will make things very clear. And the concepts under IPC, criminal law, will become very clear. Have a look at section 39 illustration. A sets fire by night to an inhabited house in a large town for the purpose of facilitating robbery. His intention is to commit robbery and thus causes the death of a person. Here A may not have intended to cause death, may even be sorry that death has been caused by his act. Yet, if he knew that he was likely to cause death, he has caused death voluntarily. You ought to know, if you put a house on fire for the purpose of facilitating robbery and it is a densely populated place, somebody is likely to die if he is asleep in the building, and especially when you do it in the dead of the night. If a person dies, even if you did not intend to kill him, you ought to have known somebody who may be sleeping inside the house is likely to die. And if he dies, it is an act which you have done voluntarily. Now, this is a very important point to explain to you. Intention is one of the forms of guilty mind, but knowledge of the consequence, likely consequence, in this case, voluntarily, is very important. And therefore, with this little background, let me take you straight away, because I don't want to spend time except that I just want to bring main highlights of the distinction between 299 and 300. Now, let me tell you, as a layman, if somebody asks you, what is culpable homicide amounting and not amounting to murder? I would say, your answer should be like this. and this I will demonstrate to you. I'm just laying broad outlines. Two basic principles I want to talk about. Culpable homicide is the genus. And murder is a species of that genus. IPC recognizes three forms of culpable homicides. Three degrees of culpable homicides. The highest degree of culpable homicide is murder punishable under Section 302 with death or life imprisonment. Please remember it. Culpable homicide of the second degree is which is punishable under Section 304, Part 1, up to life imprisonment. And culpable homicide of third degree is what is punishable under 304, Part 2 as culpable homicide not amounting to murder, where there is no intention to kill, where there is no intention to cause bodily injury, but there is knowledge of the likely consequence. Up to 10 years. Now please see. Now let me demonstrate to you what I am talking to you. I said 3 degrees of culpable homicide. Highest is 302, that is culpable homicide amounting to murder. Second is culpable homicide not amounting to murder, punishable under Section 304, Part 1, which is with intention to cause death or with the knowledge, with the intention to cause such bodily injury as is likely to cause death. And culpable homicide of third degree, which we talk about, is with the knowledge that the act is likely to cause death, but without any intention to cause death or without any intention to cause such bodily injury as is likely to cause death. Now, how do we explain it? Now, you see, a very beautiful way of approaching the problem is this. No inquiry under 299, which defines what is culpable homicide, can begin unless there is death. Because Section 3299 says, whoever causes death. Death is a sine qua non. But mere death is not enough. But death must be caused. If there is no death, there is no 299 inquiry. But merely because there is death, it does not mean 299 is attracted. You have to go further. You have to ask the question, whoever causes death by doing an act, now we said act need not to be a single act, it may be a series of acts. It need not to be single illegal omission. It may be series of illegal omissions. You may want to kill a person by not immediate starvation, but slow starvation. You want to kill a person by poisoning, but slow poisoning. So there may be series of acts involved. And the framers of the code also said, words spoken can also be act in certain cases where you know a person is suffering of a serious heart ailment and you intentionally want to kill him and by saying something which is not true and which is very fatal. You say your grandson to whom he is very greatly attached, he said he died in a road accident, which is not true. And because of this word spoken by you, he suffers a heart attack and dies. So therefore, act may be a variety of ways, including the words spoken by a person. Whoever causes death by doing an act with intention to cause death. This is the first clause of Section 299. If you intend to cause death and you do an act, proximate cause of death and death results, it is culpable homicide. So therefore, Nathuram Godse says, act, cause death of Gandhiji with intention to cause him, motive may be whatever was the motive, but it was culpable homicide. Now, clause B of Section 299 widens the scope of culpable homicide, does not confine it only to intention to kill. And this is very, very important, which I'm talking to you now. with intention to cause such bodily injury as is likely to cause death. Now mark the words. Death must happen. Death must happen by the act of the accused. Act of the accused must be accompanied by intention to cause such bodily injury which is present on the body of the deceased. And that bodily injury must be likely to cause death. So that is why if it is only may, not applicable. If it is possible, not applicable. Minimum requirement is if given to 10 people, 7 people must die by this kind of an injury. 3 people may survive. So class B of section 299 does not want intention to kill. Even if you do not have intention to kill, but you have the intention to cause the bodily injury which you have caused. And it is well established principle of law of evidence. And if you read versus in case, if you cause a bodily injury, presumption of fact is you intended to cause it unless you prove that it was accidental or unintentional. The burden is on you. Therefore, B clause is divisible into 2 parts. And both parts are disjunctive. If you draw Virsa Singh's case analogy here also. And that is, first, look at the body of the deceased. Is there a bodily injury present? Yes. Is it serious? Yes. Was it the injury that was intended by the accused? It is subjective of the offender. If it is proved that it was his injury which he wanted to cause, forget about the accused. You have to ask only objective question, answer, depending upon the medical report, postmortem report, weapon used, nature of the injury caused, and intensity of the blow. Is it likely to cause death? If given to 10 people, normal, healthy people, how many of them will survive? How many of them will die? Let's say 6 to 7 people will die. Some of them may survive. We say likely to cause death. Therefore, culpable homicide. Or, now this is most important, net gets further widened. No intention to kill, no intention to cause bodily injury. You did an act, even if you had no intention to kill, no intention to cause bodily injury. But can we attribute the knowledge to you? Mother with a child in her lap. In a panic because she is afraid of her husband, who would have physically assaulted her, who shouts at her. In panic, she jumps into the well along with the child. No intention to kill the child, no intention to cause bodily injury to the child. Yet you, as a prudent mother, ought to have known jumping into the well, the child is likely to die. And if the child dies, culpable homicide. Please be very clear on that part. Now, what did I say? I said, first clause talks about intention to kill. Second clause says intention to cause such bodily injury, and objectively such bodily injury when caused is likely to cause death and death has resulted. And third, no intention to kill, no intention to cause bodily injury, yet as a prudent person you can be attributed with the knowledge. Conscious mother ought to have known is a very dangerous act, jumping into the well along with the child. Child is likely to die, and the child dies, culpable homicide. Please be very clear on that. Now I want to take you to something more important. Because now we have to say, first step is look at whether the case falls in 299. If it does not fall, you can always go back to 304A. You can as well consider it under 325. You can as well consider it under 323. Because you have wide scope available to fix the, you know, liability. You can't leave the person like this unless his case comes under Section 80, which talks about accident or misfortune. So therefore, there is enough scope to further examine it. But if case comes in 299, any of the three clauses, you don't have to stop it there. So that is very important part that I just want to say. Now you must move to Section 300. Because culpable homicide now further has to be second stage is to test it whether it is also falling in 300. If it does not fall in 300, corresponding clauses, I'll come to those corresponding clauses in due course. It comes back as culpable homicide not amounting to murder. That is one of the eventualities. And becomes punishable under 304, depending upon whether it fell in A or B or C. If it falls in A or B, then it goes to 304 part 1. If it falls in C, it goes to 304 part 2. Please be very clear on that part. If you have any questions on that, note those questions. You can ask me in the end. I'll be very happy to answer your all anxieties on this subject. So therefore, one aspect. Second aspect, I said, don't stop it there. Now move to Section 300. Because what distinguishes 299 and 300, broadly speaking, is higher degree of the probability of the death ensuing. Higher degree of the death ensuing, probability of the death ensuing. I'll come to that distinction. Very important distinction. Section 300 starts with, except in cases hereinafter accepted. Very good aspect that you must think about. That means, except in cases hereinafter accepted, culpable homicide is murder. If it falls in any of the four clauses. But even if it falls in one of the four clauses, and it falls in one of the exceptions to Section 300, it goes back as culpable homicide, not amounting to murder. Please be very clear on that part of the matter. If it falls in 300, you further have to examine whether it is also covered by one of the exceptions to Section 300. And if it is, it comes back as culpable homicide, not amounting to murder. But if it does not fall in any of the exceptions, it becomes culpable homicide amounting to murder. Now, what is culpable homicide amounting and not amounting to murder? Let me describe before I go to the niceties of Section 300 and 299 distinction. Very clear. A case which falls in 299 but does not fall in 300 is culpable homicide not amounting to murder. Comes back as culpable homicide, not amounting to murder. And other category is a case which falls in 299, also falls in corresponding clause of Section 300, but also falls in one of the exceptions to Section 300, it becomes culpable homicide, not amounting to murder. And I'll come to the justifications of the exceptions if I have time to discuss that part of the matter. Because Section 300 starts with, except in cases hereinafter accepted. That means if it falls in those, culpable homicide is not murder. Then it comes back as culpable homicide not amounting to murder. So what is culpable homicide amounting to murder? Is when it falls in 299, it falls in 300, and does not fall in any of the exceptions to Section 300. It becomes punishable under Section 302. IPC. So therefore, I repeat again, what is murder is a case falling in 299, falling also in 300 corresponding class and not falling in any of the exceptions to section 300. What is culpable homicide not amounting to murder, a case falling in 299 but does not fall in 300, or it falls in 300 but also falls in one of the exceptions to section 300. This is the fundamental framework of section 299, 300, which you should keep in mind. Now let me go to the specifics. 299 has only three classes, whereas section 300 has four classes. And generally, if you look at various cases, and one of the cases is Punaya, R. Punaya versus State of Andhra Pradesh. State of Andhra Pradesh versus R. Punaya, where Justice Sarkaria has given the table of comparison of 299 and 300. And broadly, he states, A is comparable with 1 of 300. B of 299 is comparable with 2 and 3 of section 300. And C of 299 is comparable with 4 of section 300. Please be very clear on that part. But I would go slightly farther and bring a dimension which I always like to share and have opinions of my friends across the country, is something which is neither in the books, nor in the judgments, nor in the writings, except the writings of B.T. Kaur, is explanation one to section 300 and its significance in relation to section 299B and section 300 subclass 2. Because fundamental principle is every inquiry must start with section 299. If 299 is applicable only, then your inquiry should start with 300. You cannot jump at 300 and then say come to 299, because it's a very dangerous course. You can never come out of 299 then. But if you start with 299, you can always go back from 299. Even if 299 is not applicable, you'll still examine it somewhere else. So therefore, as a lawyer, as a judge, as a student of law, inquiry must start with 299, because there is scope to go out of it. There's a scope to go beyond it. That is where the scientific methodology that has to be adopted must be adopted whenever you are examining a case under the IPC 299-300. Now, I just wanted to bring in something which is very important, and that is where I want to add small dimension, which I do not want to take in detail today because we do not have that much of time to discuss. But I just want to add something to your, mindset, which should be your understanding. My submission to you is this. A case will fall in section 300 subclass 2 only when it first falls in section 299. And therefore, how do we bring in that element in 299? And I always say, look at the explanation 1 to section 299. I will not go to all the explanations, but I will only go to one explanation. When you go to section 299, explanation 1, it says, a person who causes bodily injury to another who is laboring under a disorder, disease, or bodily infirmity, and thereby accelerates the death of that person, shall be deemed to have caused his death. A person has a disease spleen. A person has a diseased liver. A person has a diseased heart, either of the three situations. I gave in the beginning that illustration. I said you give a blow without knowing that he is having this bodily infirmity or disease. Then my act has to be judged with respect to the people of normal health. But where I know that he is having this disease and yet we venture to give that blow, then my act has to be in relation to that person. It may be likely to cause his death, but may not be likely to cause the death of the normal human being. And this is something which you must understand, because when we go to 299 and 300 distinction, 299A is equivalent to same as is 300 subclass 1 with intention to cause death. But B2 is important. Now look at section 300 subclass 2. With intention to cause such bodily injury as the offender knows, mark the words, as the offender knows is likely to cause the death of the person to whom the harm is caused. Now it deals with the specifically people who are bodily infirmity, suffer a bodily infirmity to the knowledge of the accused. And if your blow is likely to cause his death and death is caused, it is not only culpable homicide, it is culpable homicide amounting to murder. But this is where a deterrence has been brought in, so that you do not venture to play misadventure with the people of bodily infirmity. Please be very clear. Now I would like you to kindly see. Now, if this case has been a murder, it has to be culpable homicide first. So that is why I always say, explanation one has to be read with clause B of section 299. And there has to be implicit knowledge introduced. And three cases have to be brought in section 299.3. Please understand that part of the thing. I say three cases this. 299B, where a person is a person of normal health. Second, a person of abnormal health, not to the knowledge of the accused. Third, case of person of abnormal health to the knowledge of the accused. Third becomes comparable with clause 2. And one and two cases are comparable with clause 3 of section 300. This is a food for thought, which I am leaving with you. Think over it, because otherwise it is difficult to bring a case in 300 subclass 2 unless you first bring some element of this clause in 299B at some stage. How do you do it? I say read explanation 1 along with clause B and have an implicit, did the accused know that this man was suffering of this bodily infirmity or not? If yes, it is comparable with 300 subclass 2. And that is where I would say. Now let me come to another aspect of the matter, and that is clause 3. I want to very quickly deal with these two aspects, because these are very important aspects which I want to take up today with you. Now I said, what is the distinguishing feature, broadly speaking, between 299 and 300? We say it is the higher degree of the probability of the death ensuing. Now let me demonstrate it. I said it earlier, I will demonstrate it. Now I'm demonstrating it. Look at section 300, subclass 3, which deals with the people of normal health, which deals with the people of normal health and people of abnormal health, not to the knowledge of the accused. I will not take that part. Let me take only normal health people. Look at the language. With intention to cause bodily injury, every word is important. And the intended bodily injuries are sufficient to cause death in the ordinary course of nature. With intention to cause bodily injury, and the intended bodily injuries are sufficient to cause death in the ordinary course of nature. Clause B of section 299 says, likely to cause it. With intention to cause such bodily injury as is likely to cause it. Now, the best case on this is Virsa Singh versus State of Punjab. And the principles that have been laid down in that case have become the locus classicus. And in one of the judgments and subsequent judgments, it has been repeatedly said by the Supreme Court, I am referring to State of UP versus Virendra Prasad, 2004 judgment, where the Supreme Court, referring to Vivian Bose in Virsa Singh's case, says, the test laid down by Virsa Singh for the applicability of the Clause 3 is now ingrained in our legal system and has become part of the rule of law and have become local classicus. Now, this is the kind of respectability that has been gained by the principles laid down by Justice Vivian Bose in Virsa Singh's case. And he rejected the argument. The argument that was raised in that case was, it should not only be that there should be intended bodily injury, and that accused must know that it is sufficient in the ordinary course of nature to cause death. The court rejected this argument. He said, you have to read this section, this clause in the 300, clause 3, third, disjunctively. That is very important, not conjunctively, disjunctively. And how do you read it? You have to see whether the bodily injury which is present on the body of the deceased was the intended bodily injury. That is subjective of the offender. If it was what he wanted to cause, forget about the accused. Then you have to objectively see whether these injuries are sufficient to cause death in the ordinary course of nature, irrespective of what the accused thought of these injuries. So there is a subjective test, there is an objective test. And in fact, the tests are like this, which I would like to read out to you, which is very, very important for us. The court said, it was argued with much circumlocution that the facts set out above do not disclose an offense of murder because the prosecution has not proved that there was an intention to inflict a bodily injury that was sufficient to cause death in the ordinary course of nature. It was said that the intention that section requires must be related not only to the bodily injury inflicted, but also to the clause. And the bodily injury intended to be inflicted is sufficient in the ordinary course of nature to cause death. This is the favorite argument in this kind of case, but is fallacious. If there was an intention to inflict an injury that is sufficient to cause death in the ordinary course of nature, then the intention is to kill. In that event, the third D would become unnecessary because the act would fall under the first part of the section, that is first part of section 300. If, in our opinion, the two clauses are disjunctive and separate, the first is subjective of the offender and the second part is objective inquiry, irrespective of the intention of the accused. Now, the tests that have been evolved by the Supreme Court in Virsa Singh case, let me enumerate those tests because these are the golden words that have flown from Justice Bose and have become locus classicus over the period of time. First, it must be established quite objectively that the bodily injury is present. Now, here there was, in this case, one superior thrust in the abdominal region, which brought out three coils of intestines, out of which undigested food started oozing out. The person died the next day. Just one superior thrust, the intensity of the blow was three coils of intestines came out along with the spear. Question was whether it was sufficient to cause death in the ordinary course of nature. But before that, because that was an objective inquiry, question was whether it was the intended bodily injury, that is subjective of the offender. Court said like this. First, it must establish quite objectively that a bodily injury is present. Second, the nature of the injury must be proved. These are purely objective investigation. Look at the body of the deceased. Is there a bodily injury? Is it serious bodily injury? Yes. Third, Was this injury that the accused wanted to cause? Third, it must be proved there was the intention to inflict this bodily injury, that to say it was not accidental or unintentional, or that some other kind of injury was intended. That means subjective of the offender. Once these three elements are proved to be present, inquiry further moves. And fourthly, it must be proved that injury of the type just described, made up of the three elements set out above, is sufficient in the ordinary course of nature to cause death. This part of the inquiry is purely objective and inferential and has nothing to do with the intention of the offender. Now, this has become the golden test for determining the applicability of clause thirdly. So therefore, what is requirement of 299B is likely to cause death. What is requirement of clause 3 of section 300 is not only likely to cause death, but sufficient to cause death in the ordinary course of nature. If it is sufficient, and the court said one thrust in the abdominal region, out of which three coils of intestines came out, is not only likely to cause death, but is sufficient to cause death. Left to itself, in the ordinary course, the person must die. That means only miracles can save a person. So therefore, it was a case of culpable homicide amounting to murder, because none of the exceptions to section 300 was attracted in this case. Now, let me go to the lastly. And the lastly is clause fourthly. And it's the language of fourthly you must keep in mind, which is important. If the person committing the act knows that it is so imminently dangerous that it must in all probability cause death, or such bodily injury as is likely to cause death, and commits such act without any excuse for incurring the risk of causing death or such injury as aforesaid. Now, clause C of 299 says only knowledge that the act is likely to cause death. But here it says many things. It says imminently dangerous, in all probability, likely to cause death, or such bodily injury as is likely cause, and there is no excuse. Now, it's an essential requirement of clause fourthly. And there is no excuse for incurring the risk of causing such bodily injury or death. Now, this is where you have to see, not only should the act be imminently dangerous, not only should be all probability likely to cause death, or such bodily injury is likely, almost certainty, if not certainty, something nearing certainty, that is the requirement. And further, there should be no excuse for incurring the risk of causing these bodily injuries. Three cases, and I will stop there. I'll take up. And this is a beautiful way of explaining the whole thing. And I will explain whole aspect of 299C, 300 clause fourthly, and 304A. And these three illustrations, please just keep in mind, never forget these three illustrations. I said clause C and clause fourth of 300 deal with only knowledge of the consequence, do not deal with intention to cause death or intention to cause bodily injury. You can be liable for murder even when you have no intention to kill, you have no intention to cause bodily injury. But if you have knowledge that the act is imminently dangerous, in all probability going to cause death, and there is no excuse for incurring the risk of causing death. Now, let me demonstrate three cases. All cases of mother and child. There was a lady who had a 6-month-old baby. Her husband was a cruel husband, and she wanted to go and meet her parents. He did not allow her to take the child to the parents, who were living not very far away from their place. Early in the morning, when this man was in slumber, she picked up the child and started towards her father's place, parental place. When she was some distance away from the home, nearing a railway crossing, she heard the voice. This man got out of the slumber and he found the child and wife missing, ran towards that road which led to her parental house shouted at her. She was in panic. And because of the fear that she may be beaten up by this man, she found a well nearby, jumped into the well along with the child. Child died, mother survived. One case. Second case. A wife lived with her husband and sister-in-law. And this sister-in-law would make her life miserable. And the husband would take the side of his sister. She got so fed up, one day she announced she's going to jump into the well along with the children and left for the well. Jumped into the well along with the children. Children died, mother survived. Third case. A wife who had a child on her back wanted to go and meet her parents. The husband had a fight with her, quarreled with her, did not allow her to go. She was totally upset. While going some distance away in that upset state of mind, she jumped into the well which was nearby, unmindful of the presence of the child. Child died, mother survived. In all three cases, they are put on trial. And all three cases, you will see, we have different decisions. And this is what is the beauty about law. This is the beauty of understanding the true distinction between 299, 300, and 304. Now, how did it happen? So court said, first case. They said, every mother is supposed to be a prudent mother. So she jumped into the well along with the child, imminently dangerous act. In all probability, the child was likely to die. But what did she have an excuse for incurring the risk of causing death? Now, this excuse which is used is an essential part of section 300, subclass 4D. This is very important. And the court said, excuses are legal, excuses are defenses. Partial defenses, defenses, full defenses. But this excuse is looking at the facts and circumstances of the case. Does it warrant an excuse? She was in a panicky state of mind. She was not able to decide momentarily what will be good for them and what will not be good for them. Court said, there was an excuse for incurring the risk of causing death. Essential element of section 300, subclass 4, not present, culpable homicide not amounting to murder. Second, where the girl announces that she is going to jump into the well, it is a well-considered decision. She had many other options. This is not similar to the other case. Therefore, it is no excuse. Therefore, murder. She was punished for murdering her children. And third, court said, momentarily, not mindful of the presence of the child, but had she cared to know, she would have come to know. Therefore, it was culpable negligence, not amounting to culpable homicide, punishable under section 304, subclass A. So therefore, you can see, we have tried to cover most of the areas that I wanted to cover through these three illustrations, but only one thing that I want to further cover. You see, there is rashness in 304A. Negligent or rash act, or. Negligence is the genus. Rashness is the species. The distinction is, one is knowingly negligent, second is unknowingly negligent. But she would have known that she lacked in care and caution had she taken due care and caution. Now, but when we say rashness, the rashness in 304A is of lower order, because not amounting to culpable homicide. rashness in 304 subclass C, 299 subclass C is of higher order, likely. And when we go to the rashness in 300, class 4 flea is of the highest order, imminently dangerous in all probability. So you can understand, that is why we say categorization of the offenses, it's a degree of the probability of the death ensuing. And what is negligence? We say lacking in care and caution. If you had taken due care and caution, you would have come to know that you are lacking in care and caution. Rashness, knowingly lacking in care and caution, know that it may result in death, but hope it will not, but it results because you have knowingly failed in your care and caution. I do not know whether I should take up exceptions to section 300, but I think we should give more time to the question answers. We are already 1 hour, 15 minutes ahead. So therefore, I only want to say just 5 minutes more, which I want to take, and I want to definitely take them, is because you must understand the exceptions to section 300 are all exceptions based upon suddenness. At least 1 to 4, grave and sudden provocation. Making distinction between premeditated offenses and offenses committed on the spur of the moment. Exceeding right of private defense. When you exercise right of private defense, is an unforeseen situation. And there you do not weigh your, you know, defense in golden scales. Therefore, you may bona fidely exceed your right of private defense without being, you know, acting in a cruel manner or taking undue advantage of the situation. Sudden fight. Or a person who is a public servant exceeding the authority given in law. Like suppose you have to control a mob. You cannot weigh your movements in golden scales there also. So therefore, suddenness of a situation needs sudden solutions, immediate solutions. Therefore, those are treated leniently. Only that exception 5 is talking about consent. Consent is a partial defense. Consent is not a full defense. That is, you will find in section 300, exception 5. That is why euthanasia is, unless your case is covered by common cause or other cases, is even still today culpable homicide not amounting to murder, where the person has consented to the euthanasia. So those are some of the areas, but I had something else which I think I will take up someday with Mr. Vikas. One area that I want to take up with you on some future occasion is general defenses and partial defenses, their correlations. It's something which has not been dealt with any book. This has not been dealt with by the court in any of the judgments, but I have worked on it. I have dealt with this subject, but I will definitely like someday to come and deal with these 5 defenses along with the general defenses as a separate topic. Thank you very much, and I'll be very happy to answer all your questions.
So we are thankful the way you have given the insight. It was a blissful listening for us. And as they say, that whenever it is convenient to you, we'll take you on the platform. Not only for general exceptions, but for any session, it's always a treat to hear you.
Thank you very much. Thanks a lot.
Not only me, I am saying on behalf of all those participants, I can see the messages just pouring in. And some people actually posted, but actually some people, most of them are just like in a WhatsApp group. Only 10% people participate, 90% just only read in that WhatsApp group. So same way, only 10% people respond to the session, but they are actually enjoying. And the fact that the people are not logging out of the webinar shows that even on the Facebook, it was a stagnant one that people have actually enjoyed. I'll see if there are the questions. I think that you mesmerized everyone so much that they in fact forgot to even post the questions. Except for thank you and very informative session. We haven't received any. The last one I can read, it says a fantastic articulation on nuances of 299 and 300. on. One Abdul is wanting to ask. I will unmute him.
Yeah, please.
Anybody who wants to get himself unmuted, we can do that also. Raghavendra says, what is the universal definition of an act?
Pardon?
What is the universal definition of an act?
Good afternoon, sir.
Yeah. Yes. Tell me.
Abdul, may I go ahead with the question?
Yeah.
Please. Tell me.
You talked about the probability of death. Okay.
Now, this scenario
be considered, will this scenario be considered when a male hits a woman counterpart? Okay. Now, you talked about the possibility of death. That is in May.
What I said was, you see, there are degrees which you must keep in mind. The words that have been used in the IPC are very scientific words. Very point that voluntarily talks about likely. Likely is the benchmark for voluntariness. You see, when we talk about voluntarily causing a grievous hurt, please understand. You see, if you go to Section 320 is the residuary clause of defining what is a grievous hurt. Now, grievous hurt, one of the definitions in the residuary clause you will find is endangering human life. Now, endangering human life in the context of 325 is where death is a possibility. It may result in death. But if death is only possibility, he'll still be liable only for 325. It is only when death is a likely consequence and death has happened, then he will be liable. That's why I say may, possible, likely, most likely, certainty. And when we say between the culpable homicide and murder, we say higher degree of probability. Probable, it has to be. 299 only talks about probable, likely. But 300 talks about most probable. So therefore, higher degree of probability is required. But when we talk about possibility cases will not come in 299. Even if death has taken place. That is what I was trying to make. Possible is less than likely. Likely is more than possible. Possible is more than may. May is less than possible. So you have to be very clear. That's why we say, what is rashness? A person knows that he has failed to take due care and caution, but hopes nothing untoward will happen, but it may happen. That is why we say 304A not amounting to culpable homicide. Yes, please. Yes. Somebody says he wants to ask a question. Yes. Mr. Girish. Yeah. That's what I said. You know, probabilities, because it says likely. So the benchmark for 299 is likely and death must have happened.
Mr. Girish. Mr. Abdul, kindly mute yourself. We are unmuting Mr. Girish.
Correct. You are right. Higher degree of probability is the difference between the two. Probability, it has to be. But higher degree of probability is the difference between the two.
Namaste.
Normally, if you have to explain it in a very simple way to explain is this.
Sir, namaste. Thank you for the excellent talk. My query is this. Suppose at the spur of the moment, the accused uses force to assault the victim and the victim further instigates the accused and the accused uses another force. At that point of time, there is absolutely no intention of the accused to cause any grievous injury, but it has led to a grievous injury because the victim has instigated further. Like, for example, mujhe aur marega, tu mar. So this is a common thing which happens in an argument. So when you say aur marega, tu mar, when the victim says, accused will give him another blow.
Your question brings in the point that I was wanting to tell you next time. Question is, if you are talking about Defenses under the IPC are only one of the defenses that could be talked about is private defense, right of private defense. And for that, you have to determine who is the offender, who is the defender. If you are dealing with question of grave provocation, that's a different story. It may be a mitigating factor, but it will not absolve you of the criminality. And once you take law in your own hands, you have no right of private defense. You see, very important things that criminal law, I think foundations have to be very clear. No right to punish is a sovereign function of the state. However weak the state may be, you cannot take away the right to punish it is. But your right of private defense is inversely proportional to the capacity of the state. The more the strong the state, the less the right of private defense. The more the weak the state, the more right of private defense. But right of private defense is something, is a part of the social contract theory. We know the state cannot at every step protect us. And if we wait for the state help to meet a situation, by that time we'll be raised to the ground. Ye to mana ki tagaful na karoge tum, lekin khaak ho jayenge hum tumko khabar hone tak. That is the foundation of the right of private defense, you know. You can't wait for the state help. Self-help is the best help when the protection of the state is not available to you. But you have to be very clear that you can exercise right of private defense only and only if you are a defender. If you get provoked by the exercise of the right of private defense, you cannot get provoked by the exercise of right of private defense. If you go to section 96, it's very clearly stated there. So you have to be very clear. Defenses are very clearly enumerated. Partial defenses, general defenses, nothing beyond that. You will be an offender if you do not bring your case in the general or partial defenses as provided in the IP. I think that should be able to answer your question.
Now we have Shri Ravindra. He wants to ask a question directly.
Yes, sir.
A very good evening, sir. Thank you for this wonderful session. So, sir, I have a doubt regarding this thing. Even one innocent can't be punished as per the Indian judicial system, as we say, right? Then why will a person who doesn't even have any intention to injure the other person or any intention to kill, why will he punish?
Mensuria is not only intention. Mensuria also includes a person must be responsible for his conduct. You as a prudent member of the society ought to know the consequences of your acts. And if you do a harmful act, you should be liable for punishment. You see, What do we say? Don't be rash.
Yes.
Be prudent. And that is what we section 80 says. What is the defense? Is accident or misfortune? That is all. You should not intend. You should not be attributed with the knowledge of the consequence. And you should not lack in due care and caution. If all these things are forms of mensuria, and therefore a person will become liable, like mother who jumped into the well along with the child. You know, mother became liable because mother ought to know that jumping into the well will cause the death of the child. And child is too tender a person, cannot sink, cannot swim. And therefore the child in the pond is or in the well is likely to die and is imminently dangerous act. In all probabilities, she is likely to die. So therefore, it becomes a culpable homicide and it becomes murder. But it did not become murder in one case because they said she had an excuse because of the fright she was undergoing and the panic she was put in by the presence of her husband. So therefore, those cases you must read. These are cases which are old cases. Dirajya, Gyarsi Bai, and Supadhyaya's cases. These are all the high court cases, Allahabad High Court case, Madhya Bharat case, Bombay High Court case. These cases you must all read because these give you the idea that look here, even a mother in such circumstances became liable for culpable homicide not amounting to murder.
Yes.
No, no, probability has to be, you see, don't write probability is less in 299. No. Death must be a probable consequence in 299. And it must be more probable in 300. That is the way to put it. And death must have taken place. Because death is a sine qua non for any inquiry under 299. Lucky are those who give fatal blows. People are taken to hospitals, saved. But merely because a person could have been taken to hospital, saved, is no defense, because that is what the explanation 3 talks about in section 299. I did not have time to go to that, but I just want you to read the whole of the provision yourself. So these are very important things that one must remember.
Punya says, can you give some case digest?
I think I can send to Mr. Vikas.
So I will share it in the group.
I'll share, you kindly share it with the group. I'll give you some beautiful cases. Just read those cases.
Yeah. It will be always a pleasure to.
Yeah, I'll definitely do that.
Gagan wants to ask. Gagan.
Yeah, Mr. Gagan.
Single Gagan. I want to ask the question. Gagan, you will have to unmute yourself. Gagan is not unmuting. So we don't have any other further questions.
Thank you very much. God bless you all. Read criminal law. Thoroughly, you must read all provisions, statute, good cases. It's a very fascinating subject, you know. And we need a lot of good criminal lawyers and criminal judges. Not criminal, but criminal law knowing judges.
I am reminded that in one of the webinars, the bench, the judge, he was a sitting judge, he came on our platform. He said that I am handling the criminal roster, but normally people say that he's a criminal judge.
Criminal law knowing judges, yes, criminal law experts.
Yes, sir.
Thank you very much.
Sir, one question has meanwhile come. It says, during the course of trial, mens rea should always be proved. If not proved, will the accused be acquitted?
Mens rea is an essential element of the offense, but if you see Virsa Singh, if you do an act, presumption is that you intended to do it, burden of proof shifts on you to prove that you did accidentally or unintentionally. So this is how it goes in the trial stage. This is how the trial works, you know.
And in fact,
you have to prove the mens rea. There's no doubt about it. Yes.
Once you read all these judgments, which are themselves are classic pieces to be read out.
Yeah.
Your doubts are also dispelled the same way. Like we hear the webinars by people like Kofi Annan Olive. Before we part for the day, tomorrow we will have the session on lease under the Transfer of Property Act. Concepts and Disputes with Legal Overview by Mr. Uday Hola, a senior advocate and a former advocate general of Karnataka. So do stay connected with us. Meanwhile, I will unmute Mr. Trivikram. Somehow earlier he could not be Advocates Association. Trivikram.
Mr. Vikas, good evening.
Good evening,
thank you so much for this opportunity accorded. I consider it to be a privilege. And as you rightly pointed out, we were blessed to gain knowledge from Dr. Kau. A very insightful and academically very enriching session. Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot. Thank you very much. Thank you all.
And I must definitely say this. I salute you for your enormous knowledge.
Thank you very much. Thanks a lot. Thank you very much. God bless you all. And so keep on.
We have shared the YouTube link and this thing. People can do stay connected with us. Thank you everyone. Stay safe. Thanks. Stay blessed. And sir, keep on showering your blessings as well as your knowledge to upon us. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you.